the show, we have Jean Watson coming in. And to begin with, before we bring her onto the show, we're just going to show you a background video on her, and then we will get into the interview.
Jean Watson is one of the most renowned nursing theorists of today. Her theories have become intertwined with modern-day nursing, often centering around holistic care and the meeting of client and caregiver needs. Jean Watson was born in West Virginia in the 1940s. As the youngest of 8 children, Jean found herself in an environment which focused on the value of family and community involvement. Jean first attended nursing school in Roanoke, Virginia, and upon graduating was married to her husband Douglas, whom she often described as her best friend. In Colorado, Jean continued her nursing education, eventually earning a baccalaureate degree in 1964, which she quickly followed by a master's degree in psychiatric mental health nursing in 1966. At this time, doctorates in nursing were not yet a reality, and Jean instead earned her doctorate in educational psychology and counseling in 1973. Following the attainment of her PhD, Jean assisted in initial plans for the nursing PhD programs in Colorado, as well as taking on the role of dean for the undergraduate nursing program. In 1979, she published her first book, Nursing: The Philosophy of Science and Caring, in which her theory described caring as central to nursing and posited that caring-client relationships were intrinsically related to healing, among other things. It was this theory which has served as an inspiration and guide to modern nursing education.
I think our focusing on caring as an epistemic endeavor, and if people don't understand that, they might just disregard it or discard the notion of caring as being too soft or not something we ought to pay attention to.
Since her first publication, Jean has published 2 other caring-centric books and collaborated on over 14 others. Her works have been translated into numerous foreign languages, and as a result of her scholarly work and groundbreaking theories, she has been granted 8 honorary doctoral degrees. Since her introductory theory, Jean has continued to focus on caring and nursing, as well as current issues in the nursing profession and the possibilities of future healthcare reform. In 1980, she and her colleagues established the Center for Human Caring, a center dedicated to the advancement of human caring and healing within nursing, in the hope of catalyzing healthcare reform. Presently, Jean remains a distinguished professor and nurse theorist, dividing her time between teaching her caring and healing courses at the University of Colorado and spearheading her newly created nonprofit foundation, the Watson Caring Science Institute. Jean Watson has had a remarkable life and a great number of achievements under her belt. She has undeniably changed the face of nursing education with her introduction of holistic and caring-centric nursing views. As nurses, we may wonder how Jean arrived at her theories, and how we as nurses can employ her theories in the sometimes chaotic hospital wards. Well, we're about to find out as we interview Jean Watson, next up on Nurse Talk.
Let's welcome Jean Watson to the show.
Great, I'm doing just great. How are you?
Very good. How was your travel in?
Oh, it was just splendid. You live in an absolutely beautiful area.
It is gorgeous.
Yeah, I got a very nice view of all the mountains coming over. That was great.
That's great. So you're renowned for your theories in nursing, in caring and nursing. At what point in your career did you come up with these ideas?
You know, I think that process began as a student, actually. I was in my undergraduate taking nursing, and I was very critical of the process. It was very biomedical focused, very hospital oriented, and there just didn't seem to be much of a philosophical, conceptual background to validate what the patient was experiencing throughout their health and healing and illness experience. And I was very critical of that at the beginning. It just never quite sat right with me. So I guess that's where it all began. I was fortunate to continue on and take my master's in psychiatry, and I think that's really where I found my passion. There was much more of an emphasis on understanding where the patient came from, understanding their background and their history, bringing in all those social dynamic factors into the nursing work that we were doing. And as well, I was surrounded by just by very inspiring nurses, some who actually had their doctorate in nursing, which I never thought you could do, but here I am, seemed to be one of them. And yeah, that time was a very inspirational time for me.
So that was probably your big aha moment, was when you were in that master's program and on the floor, and you could see you could see that you could actually build these meaningful relationships, and the focus was more on the client and not on this biomedical system.
Definitely. It was a move away from the hospital, and I think that's when the pieces started to come together a little bit.
That's great. Mm-hmm. So I've done some research into your theory, and the Caritas model seems to be the foundation of your theory. Mm-hmm. What were you trying to bring to nursing when you developed that Caritas model?
So the Caritas model is actually based off of what was first 10 caritative factors. And I guess when I developed those factors, I was asking myself the question, what is nursing? Is there a core to nursing that transcends the hospital, that transcends our clinical and technical tasks, if you will? Is there more to nursing than that, or are we just technicians? And when I asked myself those questions, you know, I really hoped that we were more than just technicians. I really hoped that there was more of a core to nursing, but I needed to ask those questions. I needed to find that out for myself and develop the philosophies behind that, and to integrate the integrity and the values and the ethics that we incorporate into our practice. I felt a need to explain those practices. And so I developed what are called now the 10 caritative factors. And to me, those factors are really the foundation of nursing. Those processes are what nurses do in the hospital. It's how you interact with your patients.
It's so great to hear that a nursing theorist would bring that into nursing, because I know if I'm in that hospital bed, I want to be, you know, looked after in a caring way.
And, you know, the patient really does notice the difference, and the practitioners do as well. I think if you don't integrate that caring and altruism into those interactions, then you lose the core essence of nursing. We're not just technicians.
Oh, for sure. So your theory is very conceptual and philosophical. Mm-hmm. How can nurses actually apply this to their nursing practice?
You know, I see it being done in a number of ways. I'll just start off with a great example from a couple of hospitals that I've been privileged to visit. In these hospitals, they're actually integrating what is called the care assessment scale into the daily rounds of the nurses. And to me, that is just so exciting. This is a very practical application of my theories. It's very exciting to see. And so what they're doing is actually integrating five sort of questions, I guess, into that morning routine the patient and the nurse have. And so the nurse starts off by asking the patient, was your care delivered with loving kindness, or is your care being delivered with loving kindness? And, you know, bringing that attention back to the patient and allowing the patient to have an opportunity to voice that concern, you know, that could transform the whole system, because it brings the system right around and focuses and forces the system to be more attentive to the basic human needs of the patient. And that's actually the second item on that list, is the basic human needs of the patient, which I think are often overlooked in our busy, fast-paced environment. So we have loving kindness, we have the basic human needs, we have relationships, we have building a healthy environment, and we have a belief system. So just incorporating the patient's own belief system into their care, and recognizing that we all come from very diverse backgrounds. So that is definitely one practical application that I've seen. I think in another way, nurses are just practicing nursing. You know, what I would really call the profession of nursing. They're establishing those healing environments. They're creating a climate for health and healing. They're, you know, it's things like dimming the lights or providing space for the patient to feel emotional pain or privacy. You know, it's all these things that nurses can do to support the patient and to recognize the patient as a person and to appreciate their uniqueness and their wholeness. So
that is great.
I guess those are some of the ways off the top of my head I can see it being applied in a practical sense. It's those little things that go beyond the technical skills.
Okay. So that was a great start, but we're going to go for break now.
Oh, okay.
So we will be back shortly. Thank you very much.
Great.
Welcome back to the show.
Thank you.
So I just have one more question for you, and then we're going to turn it over to some callers.
Sounds great.
So you tie in concepts of spirituality into your theory. Mm-hmm. I just was wondering if you could elaborate on spirituality a little more.
You know, this is where the theory gets a little bit complex, and I just like to quote myself, actually, just to make sure I get it right. So what I say is that humans cannot be separated from self, other, nature, and their larger universe. The caring healing paradigm is located within a cosmology that is both metaphysical and transcendent with the co-evolving human in the universe. The context calls for a sense of reverence and sacredness with regard to living, to life and all of living things. It incorporates both art and science as they are being redefined, acknowledging a convergence between the two.
We have a caller here trying to call in, so we'll just turn it on to...
Hello, Jean. Dave from Ontario here. I just wanted to say, what does that mean?
Okay, I think we're going to just cut that off. Sorry about that. So hopefully future callers will be a little more respectful than that. But I think what he was trying to get at is, like, is there a way of putting what you just said into layman's terms or just something that, you know, the general public could understand a little better?
Well, Dave, I will try to respond to your question. I guess what I am trying to say in that passage is just that we as humans are much more than just mechanical beings. We are not robots. We have a sacred energy that connects us with all living things. I can't be separated from the energy that exists in our world and in our universe. And to just recognize that energy and incorporate it into our practice. We can't just look at the patient as a physiological machine pumping blood and converting oxygen. We are much more than that. And just to recognize the depthness with which nurses and patients truly connect.
All right, that was well said. So now we'll turn it to some more callers.
Okay.
We have another caller calling in here.
Hi there, Jean. I'm just phoning in. I admire your theories. I'm just wondering, you know, the nursing floors, they're understaffed, they're really busy, and I'm under tons of pressure. And I understand what you're saying about moving away from a biomedical model and focusing on caring, but I'm having a really hard time incorporating that into my practice because I'm bogged down by pressures on the floor. How do you incorporate that into your practice?
You raise a very, yes, I would say so. You raise a very good point. You know, I think it's about finding those moments with your patients. You're right. Often, that's a complaint I hear from many nurses in many, many different floors in the hospital. We are busy, and it can be hard to find those moments with your patients. But I think the secret is to really cherish those moments that you do have with your patients. You may not have a lot of time, but when you are with that patient and you have that time, value it. You know, be present in the moment. Be self-aware. Understand the energy that you're bringing to that room and to that patient. Recognize the patient sitting in front of you as another human being and share that moment together. Something else I would encourage you to do is just to practice grounding yourself. You know, when you're rushing down the floor, you can get frantic and feel very stressed out, but I would encourage you to just take a deep breath before you enter the room of a new patient. Just be aware of what you're bringing from the last patient into the room when you go to meet another patient. I think that's something you can do. It's about being present in the moment and showing commitment and engagement with your clients and practicing self-awareness and reflexivity, understanding how you are in that moment and understanding who you bring to practice. I think becoming aware of all of that will allow you to feel more grounded and more revitalized, and hopefully that'll help you feel a little less stressed out.
Those are some great tools that you could have in a toolbox.
Yeah, you know, those are tools I like to whip out once in a while, and I think it's, as nurses, you can put them into your little phenomenological backpack, is what I'd like to say.
That is great.
Yeah. It's a really important backpack to carry as a nurse, and I just to reiterate, I'd like to put forward that... Is there something funny there?
Sorry. Just phenomenological backpack. It just seems so funny to people that are on the outside of nursing, maybe, that... Maybe you could actually explain to us what phenomenology means.
Well, phenomenology is just understanding that we are all constituted by our experiences and situated in the moment. We are contextual beings, really. We can't be separated from our experiences that we've had, and we are a result of those experiences. And just to understand that each person comes with their own history. They come with their own baggage.
Their own experiences.
Totally,
oh,
yes.
Okay. So it's
definitely
more serious.
And so when I refer to a phenomenological backpack, obviously I'm not referring to a physical backpack. It's metaphorically speaking, but there are a number of tools that as a nurse you should be carrying around.
You do use a lot of metaphor and philosophy and humanities all drawn into your theory, it seems
Yeah. Yeah,
maybe
it's
why
my passion.
Maybe why it seems so difficult for some of us to understand, but I think it's all coming together.
You know, I think it's through discussion that enlightenment happens.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's great. Okay, let's have another caller.
Hi there, Jean.
Hi.
I really love your theory, but I'm hoping to actually ask you about a particular client I have. I have this one client. He's got hypertension and left-sided heart failure.
Mm-hmm.
He refuses to follow the DASH diet and won't take his medications. And I'm just wondering, how as a nurse do I make him take these medications and make him follow this diet? He just won't do it.
You know, I think you bring a very interesting point to focus, and that is the language that you use around working with your patient. You say, how do I make him follow the DASH diet? How do I make him do what you want? And... you know, I think so often as nurses, we get wrapped up in that, paternalistic viewpoint. And again, it's biomedical. We are the experts. And I would encourage you to move away from that perspective and to really recognize that the patient is the expert of their own care. They know what is going to work for them and what's not. Nursing is not about manipulating the client to do what we see as best. Yes, we have a very sound background of science and we should use this knowledge, but it's not about manipulating, it's about understanding and supporting the patient. Mm-hmm. So again, as I just referenced, I would encourage you to use your phenomenological backpack and pull out some of those tools that we just talked about. Try to understand where the patient is coming from. What is their history? Why don't they want to use the DASH diet? Do they understand what the DASH diet is? What are some of their social, economic factors? What are things in their life that might influence their ability to adhere to such a strict regime? I mean, we are all only human. I would encourage you to consider that.
Right. So, do we have any more callers? Is that it? I think that might... there's one more caller there. That's...
Okay.
Sorry, I'll wrap it up for you guys. I won't keep you.
It's all good. I love having the calls.
That's great to hear, Gina. I'm a nursing instructor, and I really love employing nursing theory into my classes, but an opportunity to talk to an actual theorist, I'm wondering what aspects of your theory should I really convey to my students?
You know, I think it's a little bit of everything that we've just been discussing. I think there are many ways of knowing There are many ways of experiencing the world. There are many ways of being. And I think that is something to encourage your students to explore. Again, we all have our own experiences that we bring to the nurse-patient interaction. And just to highlight that, to use your nursing, your theoretical, your scientific knowledge is very important, but to also just connect with that other person as a human being. Recognize what experiences they've had. Recognize the challenges, their strengths, their weaknesses. I would also encourage you to just really explore who you bring to practice. Self-reflexivity is very important, and in order to care for someone authentically, I truly believe that you need to understand who you are yourself. We try to move away from bringing judgment and bias into our interactions, of course. I'm sure you've taught your students that. And practicing self-awareness is fundamental to that. We need to understand who we are, what our values are, what our beliefs are, so that we can avoid making those assumptions, so that we can be aware of how we are feeling and how we're reacting in the moment.
All right, that was really good to hear everything you had to say today.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I've seen that your theory has actually been integrated into many, many different curriculums across the country and the States, and then also
up here
in Selkirk College as
So
that's great. So maybe the students will start to understand a little more why, why this is all so important. And
it is. It's very important. And like you were saying, I understand that my theories can be a bit conceptual or philosophical, and that can be hard to grasp. But as you explore them, I think they become a little more clear. And I would encourage you to give me a call. I'm on email. I have a website. Contact me. I love to chat.
Okay. Well, that's all the time we have today. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.